scripture I would like to read very briefly, and I'm going to keep my remarks as brief as possible in the daylight today because we have other speakers and a lot to do. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was perfect and upright, one that feared God and eschewed evil. And if Job was a woman, her name would be Mayme. She was perfect. She was upright in all of her ways. She feared God, and she eschewed or disliked strongly, we would say, hated, that she wouldn't, evil. And if you know stories about Sister Moore that prove the point that she was not perfect, I don't ever want to hear them. Because we all need someone perfect in our life. Someone to look up to. Someone who we think is perfect. And for me, that person was Sister Moore. You can't speak about Sister Moore without speaking about him. You know, her husband of 67 years. There's no way you can mention one without the other. No one here that I know of, maybe a few that are ancient days, would know them in part, but I don't know anybody that would know you separately, and certainly I do not. So, as I speak for the next just few short moments, I would refer to both of you, because I don't know how to speak about you separately. And as I said, if Job was a woman, her name would be Betty Moore. Now, I'm not insinuating or suggesting that her spouse, Brother Moore, was like Job's wife. Wouldn't do that for $1 million. Because we all know Brother Moore would never tell her to curse God and die. That just doesn't go with Brother Moore. But we all do know that he was not quite as perfect as she was. Almost perfect.
Look at him back here.
I've always known the Moors. I cannot even remember a day in my life when I did not know the Moors. We're both from Central Texas, and although my family moved here when I was 8 to help build this church in the Assembly of God Church about 3 blocks down the street, I consider myself a person from Central Texas. And the Moores had already been here, obviously, for many years in Central Texas, whether it's north of here or south of here. They're always up and down the I-35 corridor, and so they are truly Mr. and Mrs. Central Texas. When it comes to ministry and everything else, they know the history, they love this part of the country. And how could you not know me? That silver-haired gentleman who always dressed like a banker and spoke like a statesman, flanked by his beautiful bride, who was always poised and perfectly dressed. Now, they scared me when I was a child. I'm being honest. Brother Moore always looked like he was going somewhere and had something very important to do, so I always wanted to get out of his way. I mean, he had a mission. He was on a mission from God, and that's the way I saw him as a young child, Brother Moore. But really, Sister Moore scared me more, because she always looked like that school teacher who could read your mind. And in those days, I didn't have the mind of Christ. I didn't As a young person growing up in a pastor's home, my parents always pastoring in the neighboring vicinity of the Moors, I would often hear my parents speak about other ministries and other pastors and people. And I have fond memories of hearing my mother and dad speak of Brother and Sister Moore. They always spoke of them in the highest regard. And they always remembered them as the pastors and pastors' wives who remembered what old-time revival in Central Texas looked like and wanted desperately to see that revival return to this area. As a newly married young man coming back to Christ and answering the call in my life to preach the gospel, I went to Lufkin, Texas to meet the board. The subcommittee that would question me on that day would be comprised of these three gentlemen: Brother Jerry Green, B.E. Moore and Brother John Kershaw. All I can remember about that day is that Brother Green questioned me thoroughly, as he was known to do. And Brother Moore softly asked me about my confessed testimony of being delivered from drugs and alcohol. He listened carefully with tear-filled eyes. I could see it as if it was yesterday. As I told him, I was simply just another Pentecostal preacher's kid on the way to hell, addicted to drugs and alcohol, when the grace of Jesus Christ and the mercy of God found me. And oh yes, I do remember one thing from John Kershaw. Brother Kershaw, he woke up and said, "Brother, I think we've heard enough." That's my best Kershaw. As neighbors in nearby Austin, Sheila and I would become the pastors of the Temple Christian Center, and they pastoring in Austin, we came to know the Moores as the model pastors that we would strive to be like. They were our example. They were our high watermark. They were people that they were always there. They were always doing things. And so we looked up to them in that place. But our most memorial day for the Moores was when he called me one day out of the blue, to my surprise, and asked Sister Sharp and I to meet them at Bonanza's in Austin. And they told us at that place that they were going to retire from pastoring, not from the ministry, but from pastoring in Austin. And they asked us to be their pastors. This was, still is, one of the greatest honors of our ministerial life. And we knew that if we were going to pastor the Moors, we were going to have to take it up a notch because they were truly the heroes of faith. Finally, the most needful moment with the Moors came last October, when we lost our 28-year-old baby boy in an automobile accident in Austin, Texas. The door to our home opened, and as we knew it would, and they would, the Moors came walking through it. That old, gray-headed, gospel gunslinger came walking into the door, flanked by his pure, perfect bride. Came in, and they sat down with us in our sorrow. They softly and sometimes silently help guide us through these very dark first few minutes of our journey through the valley of the shadow of death. A valley that unfortunately they knew all too well, because they had walked it many years before with the loss of their loving and only son. You see, the Moores have always been a part of our life. Sister Moore, like Job, often in trials and sickness and sorrow, suffered silently. While others around her had a lot to say, she would just sit there sometimes and listen. But when she would speak, finally, you should listen and listen well. In that soft and sweet and shaky voice that was barely above a whisper, you could hear her say some good words and certainly godly words. Because they would be words of wisdom. They would be words of truth. They would be words of trust in her God. And even sometimes words of wit. Yeah. If you didn't know it, she had quite a wit. I'll never forget. I can't do this without telling the story. It's my favorite story. I tell it a lot. Brother Moore had been with us for several years. We were pastoring him. We thought successfully. But the itch came on him again, the pastor, and there was three ladies, or four maybe, I don't know how many, in Walnut Springs, 7 miles away, that needed an interim pastor. So he came in, he sat down, they both did with us, and said, "We're thinking about being the interim pastor in Walnut Springs." And I looked at both of them, and I thought, "Now, Lord, they're free from it. Why would they go back?" I'm a pastor. I know what you mean. So I asked Sister Moore what she thought about it. She said, "I'm retired and he's retarded." And she is smiling now for him. I sense it up here. If Sister Moore had a secret sin that God was trying to expose through her trials in her life, it was pride. She had pride in her husband. pride in her son team. She had pride in her work as a professional administrative secretary, and she had pride in her fast cars. It was her secret. And if you don't know it, you do now. She loved fast cars. She loved to drive fast. When she saw a fast car, she would comment on them. And she was most animated with her speech when you got her talking about fast cars. As a matter of fact, she loved to tell the story of how Brother Moore and her were just sparking. She had her car and he had his car, and she raced him. And I beat him, she said. And every time she told the story, she beat him by a little more. So, if she wasn't perfect. If she wasn't perfect. The final verse in the book of Job says it like this. So Job died, being old and full of days. Sister Moore has made it through her chapters of trial and toil. Now she has entered into her eternal chapter, where she receives her reward of a double portion for her doing her duties down here. Sister Betty Moore is and always will be my perfect person. Love you.
Someday when life is over, 2020 at a local hospital. Funeral services are today at 10 a.m. Saturday, May 30th at River City Church. She was born in Waco, Texas on March 12, 1934 to George W. and Mayme Co. Eddleman. She attended local public schools and graduated from Waco High School. Shortly after graduation, she met the love of her life, William E. Moore, and they were married. A love story that lasted 67 wonderful years. She showed her devotion and love to the Lord as she served as pastor's wife and assisting him in service to the Lord. A better description of Miss Moore is found in Proverbs 31, beginning with verse 10. And you will find that on the insert, and I encourage you to read that. She was a delight to be around. She loved to sing and knew the words to many hymns. She was a wonder in the kitchen, and especially known for her chicken and dumplings. Miss Moore was preceded in death by her parents, her son, Timothy Eugene Moore, and brother Charles Eddleman. She is survived by her loving husband, Pastor William E. Moore, brother Gary Eddleman, and wife Susan, and many nieces, nephews, and cousins. I saw a sign not too long ago. I thought it was a very interesting sign. It said, "Just married," and then in quotations below that, it said 67 years ago. And I thought, man, I've got to mention that to open it up. Because Uncle Bill and Aunt Sissy had that just married love and passion for one another and excitement. That is commitment. And that certainly is an example to our young people today, our young married people, our middle-aged married people, of how commitment looks. I'm approaching 26 years of marriage this summer. And I tell my wife, I said, look, if you ever leave me, I'm going with you. And if there's anything Aunt Sissy showed me, it was commitment. So I'm going with you, wherever that may take me. But three words really come to mind for Aunt Sissy. Faith, the faith that she had in our loving Jesus Christ. Her marriage to Uncle Bill, and the service that she provided to others. And with the marriage, and Brother Sharp mentioned this, you can't think of one without the other. And so, while we were at Uncle Bill's the other night, we were looking through some pictures, and I came across a 50-year wedding anniversary memorandum. And Uncle Bill had provided his story how he met Aunt Sissy, and Aunt Sissy provided her story of how she met him. So I thought I would, with Bill's permission, I thought I would share that with you today, and we'll see just how close they line up with their words of prayer. So Bill's story. The first time I saw Eddie was at a service at Brother Hoffman's Pastoric, the First Pentecostal Church of Waco. My mother told me about a youth revival three young men were holding. When I arrived at the service early, I met a young fellow by the name of Gene Brown. We sat in the back of two young ladies in the service. One was Betty Eddleman, and the other one was her cousin, Betty Coe. During the course of the service, I asked Betty Eddleman for her phone number. She tore a piece of paper from a camera film box with the name of Fox Film Company and handed it to me. That was our first meeting. I later learned she went up the street to where Brother Lamb pastored. I visited up there, and I dated her cousin, Betty Coe, and later I dated Betty Eddleman. And the more I dated her, the more I liked her. Her mom and dad worked at night. she kept her little brother some of the time, and we had boys with us when we would go riding around town. The weekends, we were to ourselves. We really enjoyed the weekends, riding around, eating hamburgers at Cup's Drive-In, and grilled cheese sandwiches at the Shamrock Restaurant at the Circle. One night, Gene and I were together in my dad's 49 Ford, and it was pretty new. We saw the two daddies together and was trying to overtake them. They took a turn we didn't know about, and we drove down Highway 77 very fast, trying to catch up with them. We were going so fast, I lost the sun visor I had put on Dad's car. Through the months we dated, I felt I loved this girl. And after a summer of not dating, she called me at work and told me, as leaving me a note in her car, for me to pick her up after work. I told her I would meet her if she wanted me to. It was that evening I proposed to her, and she accepted. This was in September of 1952. We decided we would marry in December if her mother approved. And if not, we would wait until born. That's being patient. We married December 6, 1952, and this has been a great time together for 50, but now 67 years. I love her more today. I feel that I did when I proposed to her. Now let's see how Daddy's version of that lines up with Bill's. It was in the year of 1951 that I met Bill, and at that time, I didn't give it much thought. We already have a difference. Brother Masha's church in Waco was having a revival with three young, good-looking men. Brother James Hosh, T.W. Hosh, and George L. Gass, Jr. I was attending the revival service one Friday night with a cousin of mine, Betty Coe. So now we got some similarity. When we got there that night, we sat a little towards the back, and behind us were two young men named Bill Moore and his friend, Gene Brown. Sometime during the evening, Bill asked me for my phone number. I looked in my purse, and I found a phone number from some film I had developed from the Fox Company, and I gave him that phone number. That's kind of mean, isn't it? I was attending Brother Lamb's church at the time, and the next service or so, who appeared to be but Bill Moore. And it was at that time we started dating. At first, we did not get along very well. I missed that on the bills. My mother never did think that we would work out, but after 50 years together, I can say today that my love is very strong, you know, and he has always been there. I don't think I really even knew what love was. But today, I am thankful for all the ups and downs that we experienced together. I do want to take this opportunity to just say thank you on behalf of Uncle Bill and the family. One, for being here. Just got an overwhelming large group here to honor Aunt Sissy and Uncle Bill. And what I used to say back when we lived in East Texas, I'd say, them's good people. Mm-hmm. These are good people. I also want to thank you for the love and support that you've given him in the past, in this past week. And for the prayers provided, and particularly the prayers. prayers that's going to be needed as we define this next step for Uncle Bill. I also want to give some special recognition to Tammy Macy for the work that she is putting in, the pictures, the photos, the organization. It's just been great. I also want to give a special recognition to my brother Rick Jackson for his time spent with Uncle Bill at a time that was just so critical this week. And he's been there with me. And also Mary King and Johnny Jordan for their generosity of ensuring that Uncle Bill had plenty of hamburgers this week. And let me tell you, he took full advantage of every hamburger. God bless you. I love you. Thank you.
Thank you. you were to do a DNA test on Texas, you're going to find Mayme in the genetics and the Texas district. Everyone. They love God. They serve the Lord. Serve. I was thinking 40 years ago, I had a vocal license, I guess every time
course, our district superintendent. We honor brother and sister Story for being here today, and also brother and sister Russo, our former district superintendent. Wow. But let's give them a good hand today. And then I do want to thank the River City Church and Pastor Robert and Chris Nelson for opening these facilities for us and being so kind. Brother Nelson's never been anything but kind to me, and I thank the Lord for that today. And on these nights that we're enjoying for this service with Sister Moore, let's give this church a hand. Immediately following this service, there will be an interment at the Rosemount Cemetery on South 12th and Garden Drive. And then family and ministry are invited back here. I think there's enough food for everybody. We're invited back here to the church as Waco Life and Lewisburg UPC will be serving a meal in the fellowship hall down the hallway. Just as you come in the door, you'll see that. And this is a great day. This is a great day. Furthermore, I want to tell you to be encouraged, and I want to have this congregation to be encouraged. I know you've been here a while, but I'm at the end of the train, so you can be encouraged. And I want Sister Lavada to come back to this piano, and before she does, I do have something special. I too honor Sister Connie Bernard today, and where's Sister Bernard? There she is. Won't you stand, Sister Bernard? Brother Story's already today. She's the first lady of the Bible school, but here she is today, and we honor her today. And she has written a letter for me to read, a note today to Brother Moore about Sister Moore. And it simply says, "Brother and Sister Moore were my pastor and pastor's wife in my teenage years. If I can think of one word to describe Sister Moore, that word would be the word sweet. She always had a smile on her face, and she had great love. She was not afraid to love anyone. She was what I call the sweet mother of the church. To me, the main role of the pastor's wife is to love the people in their congregation, and Sister Moore exceeded in this role. My mother is here with me today, and she worked closely with Sister Moore on many projects. I asked her what were some special things that she remembered about Sister Moore. One thing that stuck out to her was Sister Moore's love for shoes." Sister Bernard says, "And I agree. She was also helpful and involved in every function that the church had. She was not afraid to get right in the middle of what was going on, whether it be ceramics, luncheons, fundraisers, whatever. She was there. And I know without a doubt, the most important thing in her life was her love for and relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. She has, as I am sure, greeted her master, and probably has her favorite pair of shoes on. God bless you, Brother Moore, and know that Brother Bernard and I will keep you in our prayers with much love. Sister Connie Bernard." Praise the Lord. Let's thank the Lord for it. Lord, we love you. We thank you, God, for being today in this service. We ask you, Lord, to help us remember the good things about Sister Moore and example that she set forth. And as we worship you today, Lord, we ask you to touch our minds and our spirits. Thank you, Jesus. I think we'd be remiss if we didn't just worship a little bit. Let's stand together. Sister Moore knew the words for every song that didn't have written in 2020 or 1820. She knew the words for out of series, new and old. Do look out there and get that. She's not going to know that. Faith led singing 2 weeks ago. And she sang all these songs in every church. I said, "Faith, you got to put some old songs in there sometime." But I looked out there and Sister Moore was singing every word of every one of them. Every word of every song. And she knew them all. But she loved this one. We're going to worship a little bit. We'll worship with us now. Well, it's some land. Oh, what a time we've had together. And Sister Strong has a tribute to Sister Moore that she wants me to read today. If that's okay, Brother Moore, I'm going to do that. And she simply said, the epitome of class, an understatement, it's true. When you walk into the room, all eyes turn on you. With your cowboy by your side, his cowboy hat on his head, you walked in complete comfort, knowing by God's truth he was led. Adorned with the cute clothes you always wore and classy shoes on your feet, you always represented Christ to everyone you would meet. You were truly always so much fun. People of all ages loved you so. You involved yourself wholly everywhere you would go. Your voice became silent. Your spirit, it rose to a higher calling as your name he chose. Heaven became sweeter. The choir welcomed you there. You will know streets of gold. No pain or sorrow again you'll have to bear. Someday my sweet friend will meet you again by the pearly gates so bright. Well done, we will hear Jesus say, and there's no pardon in sight. I love you, Sister Moore, Sister Strong. It has truly been one of the joys of my salvation to be acquainted with people of the caliber of Brother and Sister Moore. They're truly lovely people. Many things have already been said about Sister Moore today, and sincerely, there is no possible way to capture in one setting the type of woman that she was. She was the homemaker that everybody talked about, and yes, her recipe and knack for making chicken and dumplings will simply die with her today. She also loved to eat out. Now, Sister Moore loved a good tamale. She loved that we went out. For 10 years we've been going out every Sunday. And so, now they made fun of me because I like Mexican food so much, but Sister Moore run me a pretty good race. She loved Mexican food. She got tamales. She loved tamales. Furthermore, I don't know if I can go to Don Carlos now, but she's gone because she loved it so much. She was the superior conversationalist. She intensely loved young people and invested in their lives. She freely offered valuable advice. In fact, Sister Moore could instruct you, and you wouldn't realize it until about 2 hours later that she had kind of given you a tongue lash and told you what to do, and you think, well, that's what she was saying. She could do it in such a way that you didn't even know what was going on. She was a woman who loved to pray. She loved good church. She loved good preaching. And she loved good worship. She loved and she honored her husband. They sang together. They taught. They evangelized. For 20 years, she stood beside him as a part of the Texas District Board as a preacher's wife there. They ran a daycare together. They were on the youth committee together as he was youth secretary for many years. And then they pastored 6 churches. They pastored in Blum, Kingsville, Port Lavaca, Cleveland, Austin, and then when they were supposed to be retired, they pastored in Walnut Springs. It has already been stated that she was the longest running district ladies ministry's secretary of the Texas District, 25 years. She joked with Sister Strong and Sister Green many times that they had it easy because she didn't have a computer when she did it. She did everything by hand. She was quite the jokester. She had a calm, dry sense of humor. She went to work right out of high school as a secretary. She was a typist and knew shorthand. For over a decade, she worked when they pastored in Austin. She worked as the office manager for a doctor there and retired from that job. Sister Moore loved the church, and she was so glad to be back in Waco. She loved all the saints of God, loved her family, her nieces, nephews, Rock and Rick, so special to her. Tammy, the daughter she never had. She loved Tammy. As a young person, Tammy said, I never went to Austin, but I didn't come home with a new pair of shoes. Melissa and Gary, she loved them all. She loved her cousins, and it was her joy, Brother Cove, to go to church with you. Such a treat for her. And then her husband, she honored and revered Brother Moore so much. It's already been stated they married at 18, much has been said about that. One thing that was not said was that a lady, or a young lady at that time, could marry at 18 without a special signature, but a young man could not. And so Brother Moore had to have his parents to sign his marriage license in order to marry Sister Moore. Maybe that's why her mother was concerned, I don't know. But they were one flesh for 67 years, hand in hand. They loved each other so much. Where you saw one, you saw the other. They were truly companions. Her love for Brother Moore was seen in the way she looked at him and heard in the manner by which she spoke to him and of him. When he was teaching, preaching, or leading service, her very visage showed how much she loved and revered her husband. What an example for all to behold, this beautiful couple. And we would be remiss today if we did not mention her only son, Tim, who was taken too young. She kept his picture front and center in their home, and he was front and center in her thoughts. We just celebrated Mother's Day. She told me about two Mother's Days ago, tears streaming down her face at a restaurant. I don't know if you're on Mother's Day. She said, for the strong Mother's Day is the hardest day of the year for me. She's told me a story many times how that Tim would bring her yellow roses. And that's why Brother Moore in his casket spray, he's got one yellow rose right in the middle to represent their son who loved his mother. We celebrated that Mother's Day, and I thought this Mother's Day, as I looked out in the audience at how sad she was, but could I tell you today, she'll never have another sad Mother's Day. That was her last one. I do feel like the brochure and the writer of Proverbs 31 in saying, who can find a virtuous woman? I'm full aware that question was written with a rhetorical nature in mind, that if for a minute we could put it in an interrogative sense and consider it as a question, who can find a virtuous woman? Could I tell you, we found a virtuous woman today. Sister Moore was truly the Proverbs 31 lady in that she fulfilled all of the qualities that a lady of God should be. She represented and exemplified so many qualities of women that we find gracing both the Old and New Testament. A virtuous woman, yes. She was like the first woman, Eve, in that she was at perfect peace with her God and her husband. She was like Sarah, in that she was a loyal wife who did what was right and did not give in to the fear that surrounded her. She was like Hagar, in that she obeyed God's voice as soon as she heard it. She was like Rebecca. She was a servant who went the extra mile and desired to see the face of the Son. We could call her Leah today in that she was content in worshiping. We could say she was like Jochebed in that she acted heroically in the midst of adverse circumstances. We could name her Miriam because she showed fortitude and wisdom and led others in worship. As Rahab was, so was Sister Moore, clever and full of faith. Like Deborah, she was a prophetess who heard God's voice, and she obeyed it. We can name her Naomi because she believed in God's sovereignty and in his plan. Ruth, she was obedient, generous, loving, and loyal. She was like Hannah in that she knew how to pour out her heart to God. She was like Abigail in that she was quick-witted and she was a peacemaker. The widow of Zarephath in that she showed hospitality and Sister Moore lived by faith. We could call her the Shunammite woman in that she never gave up on God coming through in the time of a crisis. Queen Esther, because she had considerable beauty and she always practiced social graces. She fulfilled every aspect of the Proverbs 31 lady. And moving to the New Testament, we could call her Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, Because, yes, Brother Sharp, she was blameless and upright in the sight of God. Mary, the mother of Jesus, because many times she had responded, "Yes, Lord, be it unto me," even though I don't understand. We could call her Anna the prophetess because she fasted and prayed with tenacity. Joanna, because she gave herself to God totally. Martha, because she was industrious in her work for the Lord. And Mary, because she loved to worship and sit at the feet of the Lord. She was like Dorcas in that she was always doing practical works of mercy. We could call her Lydia today because she was a leader of other ladies. Mary Magdalene in that she loved Jesus until the very end. The woman of Samaria in that she witnessed wherever she went. Her name could have been Priscilla because she was a helper in Christ. She could have been Peter's mother-in-law because though she had just been sick, she always found a way to serve the ministry. She could have been the mother of Rufus in that she became a mother to many people. Her name could be Phoebe because she was a securer of many, and as Paul said, and of myself also. The Syrophoenician woman in that she exhibited great faith. And lastly, she was definitely like Lois and Eunice in that she led her unfeigned faith and impetus to encourage young preachers. What a woman. I thank you, family, and virtuous woman. I thank you, family. And she believed the scripture so strongly that she knew that no man could be saved unless he had been born again of the water and of the Spirit. Sister Moore received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, and she was baptized in the lovely name of Jesus at 8 years old. She was born again 78 years ago, and so she lives today. Her spirit never died. Amen. She was a believer in worship and prayer, in giving, and showing the love of God, and living on the highway of holiness. Through many trials and many troubles, she trusted the Lord. Just a few years ago, she went through a heart attack, and we thought we were going to lose her, but she bounced back. She went through a brain tumor, and we thought, this is it for Sister Moore. She bounced back, and she was right there on that second row in church. Many other sicknesses, but her faith in God sustained her. She believed in healing, miracles, the moving of God's Spirit, holiness. She was a one God, Jesus' name believer. She loved this gospel, and she was not ashamed of it. Sister Moore kept her spirit alive in her. In fact, it was just a day and a half before her final journey that she was in the house of God. When I spoke to her, "How are you doing, Sister Moore?" "Well, I'm doing fine, doing strong. Doing fine." I had already talked to her, hugged her dad, shook her hand. I was going out the door, and she turned around, and she said, "Brother Strong, I'll see you later." I said, "I'll see you later, Sister Moore." "We'll see her later, woman. We'll see her later. We'll see her over there." She told Brother Moore before that service on Sunday. I don't know if it was on the way to church or while they were getting dressed. She said, "Honey, there's something in me today that I've got to go to church." I said, "Well, we're going to church." She said, "No, today I've got to be in church today." She was in church that last Sunday. Amen. Do you know where we'll see this virtuous woman again? The body that lies before us today is just a shell that she lived in for 86 years. Her spirit is with the Lord. Paul said, "If I'm absent with you, then I'm present with the Lord." Let me encourage you that there will be a resurrection morning. Sister Moore was full of the Holy Ghost. And there's coming a day soon when the Lord, just as he sent an angel to announce his first arrival, he'll tell the angel to pick up the trumpet and blow it up because he's coming back. Paul said, "The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout." Amen. He said, "I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not as others which have no hope." He said, for this we say, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain are not going to prevent the coming of the Lord. We're not going to prevent those that are asleep. We're not going to stop this. But the Lord's going to descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall come alive first. The dead shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so say, comfort one another with these words. Hey, if we can have any comfort today, our comfort is that we're going to be together. Amen. And we're born. Such a way that you're going to meet her and be with her, and then you're going to be with him. That's how great our God is today, how great our love is. Hey, you talk about a comfort today. We have a comfort in the Holy Ghost that we will see her again and we will be with her again. It's our loss today, but it's heaven's gain. It's heaven's gain. There's coming a resurrection. And Sister Moore obeyed the Acts 2:38 plan. And she prepared herself for that resurrection. The Apostle Paul said it like this. He said, to me, to live, or living, or walking on this life, having this existence, that's gain. That's Christ, that's everything. I'm living for Christ. That's what Sister Moore did. She lived for God. Her life was to live for God. When she woke up in the morning, she said, this is Christ. But then Paul said, let's die. That's even a little bit better. It's gain. It's going the next step. Sister Moore lived for the Lord. She lived for church. She lived for the propagation of the gospel. But then there's a gain. There's something higher than that, Brother Moore. She's gone to a greater existence. What gain? Streets of gold. And I read my mind, we don't just say streets of gold. It says it's a city of gold. Walls of jasper, gates of pearl, angel choir singing, the face of the Lord. That's the gain that Paul spoke of. It happened so quickly, early Tuesday morning, she took her last breath in this life. And then she had gain, and she started breathing over there. It's a place where the sun never sets, the flowers are always in bloom. There are no ravenous beasts there, cloudless skies. And I say congratulations, Sister Moore. She's made it. It's reward time for her. There's going to come a time like this for each and every one of us if the Lord tarries. And I hope we will follow her example to be ready for that day. Let's prepare ourselves as Sister Moore did. I'm comforted to know that the rapture of the church is a reality. The resurrection of the saints is certain, and a heaven is awaiting. Could we all pray together? Lord, we love you so much, and I'm so thankful for your presence that is in this place today. I thank you for everything that has been said and all the good remembrances of Brother and Sister Moore. Lord, we thank you for her life and her sweet nature and the love that she had for us and our families, the instruction that she gave us. Lord, let us never forget the things that she taught us, but let them forever be preeminent in our minds. God, I ask you, Lord, to comfort Brother Moore in the days ahead. Walk close to him, Lord. Let him know that you're with him when he wakes up in the morning, and when he lies down to rest at night. Be right with him, Lord. Speak to him, Lord, and talk to him, and help him to make some sense out of all of this. And I give you the glory and the praise, and we take comfort in knowing that you're with us today. We love you, Jesus. In the lovely name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.